All right, let's quickly revise financial instrument topic through the charts. First, meaning of financial instrument means what? It is a contract that will create either a financial asset to one entity, financial liability or equity to another entity, correct?
Yeah.
It should be a contract. So something which does not arise as part of contract, like income tax obligations, constructive obligation as per Ind AS 37. They are not financial instruments. Went through this, correct?
Yeah.
Financial asset means six features: cash including bank deposits, equity instruments of another entity, contractual right to receive cash or any other financial asset, correct? Or to exchange financial asset or financial liability under favorable conditions. Yes. Fifth one, derivative. Second one is receiving variable number of own equity shares.
Yes.
Correct? No. Those are your six features. PPEs, inventory, intangible assets, prepaid expense like salary paid, they are not financial assets. Yes, because we don't have a contractual right to receive cash on them. There is an opportunity to generate cash on them, but we don't have a contractual right to receive cash. Hence, they're not financial assets. Done now. Financial liability means what? You don't have to redo the definition. First two definition of financial asset you cut. Remaining four features will obviously be there. Correct or no? So that is your financial liability. That is contractual obligation to pay cash or any other financial asset, or to exchange financial asset or financial liability under unfavorable condition, or to pay your own equity shares under but variable number of equity shares. And last one is derivative, correct? No. That is your financial liability. Equity means what, sir? It's an instrument that gives you residual interest in something. What is that something? Net assets of the company, correct? If you in equity means there is no obligation, and equity shares are generally non-putable, and one test has to be satisfied if you have to classify it as an equity. That is fixed to fix test, correct? No. Only both what? Two things has to be fixed, both consideration as well as number of equity shares, both has to be fixed. It can vary due to circumstance, still you'll classify it as equity. That is what? Based on passage of time if it varies, or due to stock split or bonus if it varies, or if it varies due to foreign currency, then still it is shown as equity only, correct? No. If any other factor if it is varying, then we'll classify that as a financial liability, correct? No. All right, next. Putable instruments. Putable instruments means what? The holder. You have sold the shares. You have sold with put option, meaning the holder has an option to sell the shares back to you. Correct? No. At a particular price. So holder has a right to sell the instrument back to cash for the issuer. Correct? No. Okay. Or it automatically gets put back on when certain things happen. When there is a death or if there is a retirement of the holder, then automatically it gets put back. Fine? No. Now, certain class of putable equity instruments can be classified as equity. If it features, if I think five conditions, if it is satisfied, we classify it as equity. One is what? They should get only pro rata share in net assets on liquidation.
Okay.
And it should be most subordinate to other instruments. All this we have learned, sir. Yes or no, we are revising. Yeah. Third one, they should have identical features. Putable instrument means one obligation you have, that is to pay cash. Other than that, there should not be any extra obligation to pay cash or any other financial assets. Done now. Last one, the return that you give to putable shares should only be based on P&L or change in net assets, like equity. All these are features of equity, correct? No. If putable instruments also have these features, means then you can classify this putable instrument as equity. Otherwise, it will be classified as financial liability. Okay, so that is your putable instruments. Can you reclassify from financial liability to equity?
Yes.
Yes. Since you're going from equity, does equity is a residual value? Does it have any fair value? There's no point in booking equity at fair value, no. Hence, we transfer is done at what? CA. CA means what? Carrying amount. Correct? Since you're using carrying amount, there'll not be any difference. So, there'll be no gain loss.
Yes.
But if you're going from equity to financial liability, then the reclassification, you have to use fair value. Since you're using fair value, there'll be some gain or loss. That gain or loss should be going into equity. Yes or no? That's what we mean by difference. Difference means gain or loss. Fine, no? Alright, seventh one. Return put option over the non-controlling interest. Holding company has a return put option to non-controlling interest, guys. Yes, no. For this, if they have received any premium, premium received will be recorded through equity. Correct, no. Record a financial liability at present value of cash outflow by debiting equity and crediting financial liability. Why are we debiting equity and crediting financial liability? Did you understand the meaning of this term? Or forgotten? Okay, forgotten. Okay, at least he's honest. There is subsidiary company. There is holding company. Okay, holding company has written put option to NCI. NCI means what?
Non-controlling
interest. Let's say holding company owns 90% of S. That means NCI holds 10%. Holding company is telling, has written a put option to these guys. If you want, sell this 10% shares back to me. Correct? No? Any confusion?
No.
This is anyway happening between these two companies. No. S has no role to play in it.
Yeah.
In S books, nothing will happen.
Yeah.
But you remember, we prepare something known as consolidated financial statements.
Yeah.
From console, from group perspective, if this guy decides to sell, H Limited has to pay cash.
Yeah.
That means there is an obligation. If there, since there from group perspective there is an obligation, you have to show financial liability is what I've told. Yes or no?
No?
Correct? That is accounted. Did we receive any cash for this obligation? We received only premium. For premium, you showed it as equity. We wrote the entry bank account debit to equity. Correct? No? But you have to create obligation also now. No? That means you have to credit financial liability. You have to debit something for that. So what will you debit? Equity. This is okay. So equity account debit of financial liability is what the entry we have done. Problem, go through that problem. Maybe you have forgotten or you have not revised. Okay, if you have revised, you should have got this. So journal entry, when you receive the premium, it will be bank account debit to equity. Let's say you receive 10 rupees premium. You will write bank to equity 10 rupees. You have an obligation, let's say, to pay 50 rupees. That means you have to create financial liability to financial liability 50. Did you receive this 50 rupees?
No.
No. Are you going to receive this 50 rupees? Are you going to receive or are you going to pay, sir? You have to pay, no? He is going to sell, so you're going to pay the money. Hence, you have to debit equity account debit to financial liability 50-50. So we have done. For this financial liability, you follow ACM method. Regular ACM method. Fair enough. On the settlement date, it is a put option. No? If NCI wants, he will sell the shares to you or he will not sell. If he exercises the option, that means you have to pay this financial liability to him. So that means you will pay this 50 rupees to him. No. So financial liability to bank 50 rupees. If he doesn't exercise, obligation over. So financial account debit to equity. Because to create obligation, you pass the entry equity to financial liability. No. If there is no more obligation, reverse it. We have done a question. Yes. Maybe forgotten. Okay, so no. I can understand. Too many concepts in this. Done, no. Compound financial instruments. Compound financial instruments means what, sir? It has features of both equity and financial liability. That means you have to split. How do you split? First, you have to find out financial liability portion. How do you find out that? Present value of future cash flows at effective interest rate.
Yes, sir.
Out of the total proceeds, if you deduct financial liability portion, you will get equity portion.
Yes, sir.
And financial liability is accounted as per ACM method.
Yes.
That's all. On settlement, if you redeem it, then you will say financial liability account debit to bank. That financial liability we have assumed it as 8% debentures. Okay, just to give you a little clarity. Fine. If you are redeeming it, financial liability to bank. If you opt for conversion, then financial liability portion you transfer to equity. And then from equity, you will give equity shares. No, you transfer to equity share capital and security premium. Yes, no? This is what we have done in problems also, correct? Okay. Am I going very, very faster? Or making sense? Making sense. Okay. It should die. It is revision. We have to do fast only. The whole thing we have done slow only. No? This one at least we should go a little fast. Okay, treasury shares. Treasury shares means I told it's a buyback accounting. You're buying your own shares back. Alright. Can you show your own shares as an asset, sir? Never. Your own shares can never be shown as an asset. You can't recognize that as a financial asset. Okay. And all this adjustment is happening between company and shareholders. All this is related to equity. What did I say? Anything related to equity will be adjusted in equity only. So everything, consideration received, premium, blah, 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 everything will be related to, will be done in equity only. You will not touch P&L. Everything will be adjusted through equity portion only. Fine, huh? No gain loss accounted in P&L when own equity shares are bought back. Every adjustment is done through equity itself. Done?
Yeah.
Okay. Interest, dividend, gain and loss. If it is relates to financial liability, you will obviously transfer it off to P&L. If it relates to equity, on equity shares if you pay dividend, will you show it in P&L or it will be adjusted in equity only?
Equity.
Adjustment. If you have any transaction cost,
yeah.
If you have transaction cost for equity instruments, what do you do? Adjust it in equity itself. Yes?
Yeah.
But if you have on compound financial instrument, if you have a transaction cost, then what do you have to do? Compound financial instrument means you have to split between equity and financial liability.
Yes.
Hence, transaction cost also has to be split between them in their carrying amount ratio. Initially, you will split CFI into equity and financial liability. In the same ratio, you allocate transaction cost also. Again, we have done a problem on all this. Just a theory. I know.
Yes, sir.
Offsetting. Can you offset financial asset and financial liability? Yes, provided you have a legal right to do so and you also intend to do so. Okay, you have a legal right as well as you have intention to do so. You remember we had a tri-party example again, A, B, C.
Yeah.
So the tri-party agreement is that. Fine, no.
Yeah.
This is offsetting. Next, measurement of financial asset. How do you measure financial asset? ACM, FET, OCI, FETPL. I think now we are comfortable with ACM and all. I'll not go. Correct? No. FET, OCI means what do you do, sir? What is the business? Or maybe ACM method ka business. What is the business model for ACM? Business model is to hold and collect the contractual cash flows. Yes or no? And that contractual cash flow should be sole representation of principal and interest. If this is satisfied, you'll do ACM. What is the business model for FET, OCI? Business model would be to hold some, sell some. Objective would be satisfied by both by holding as well as by selling. And CCF test also has to be satisfied. And FETPL is a residual category. If you can't fit into these two, you'll bring it into FETPL category. Now, no. CCF ka characteristics. How do you define something as CCF? It should be consistent with something. What is that consistency with? It should be consistent with basic lending arrangement. Yes or no? In basic lending arrangement, what and all you'll consider? Time value money you'll consider, credit risk you'll consider, liquidity risk you'll consider, prepayment penalty, all this is considered. Yes or no? Anything other than this if you're considering, then it is not inconsistent with basic lending arrangement. Like linking with index. If you link with inflation index or CPI, it is fine. But it should not be leveraged. Yes or no? You saw one problem. But if you link it with equity index or debtors ka performance, then it is not consistent with basic lending arrangement. Your CCF test will fail there. Okay, no? Suppose you linked it with inverse floating interest rate. If market increases by 1%, means I will give you 1% lesser. That is inverse, no? Then also CCF test will fail. Yes or no? If you are in sync with the market, CCF will pass. If you are off, then CCF will fail. Done? Okay. Next, transaction price. What do you do for transaction cost, sir? If you're doing ACM method or FET OCM method, transaction cost will be added.
Yeah.
Once you add that, transaction price will not be same. It will change, no? That changed, we're calling it as RTP, revised transaction price. Yes or no?
Yes.
But if you're following FETPL method, then transaction cost will you add? Will you add? Actually, it should be nil. Correct, because this goes to where? Transaction goes to SPL in case of FETPL. Correct, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, initially you will measure financial asset at what, sir? But before you get to that, first you have to check whether transaction is at market terms or off market terms. If it is at market terms, then you will measure it at RTP. Why RTP? Because transaction cost you need to adjust, no? Hence, we are not taking transaction price, we are taking revised transaction price. Fine, no? Alright, if it is at off market price, means we have to find out fair value. You can find out fair value based on level 1 inputs or valuation technique. In that case, the difference between RTP and fair value will go to SPL immediately. Due to any other reason or any other basis if you are using, like present value of cash flows and all, then the difference will be amortized to SPL. Okay, no?
Yeah.
Alright, next. How do you subsequently measure financial asset? ACM, FET, OCI, FETPL. ACM we know, no? Effective interest rate we require, CCF we require, correct, no? FET OCI means it is measured at fair value, and that fair value gain loss will go off to OCI.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Alright. FETPL means everything will go off to P&L, whether realized gain or unrealized gains, everything to P&L. Financial liability measurement. Here there are only two categories, ACM and FETPL. Can you shift from ACM to FETPL? Not allowed. Only for financial asset reclassification is allowed. For financial liability, reclassification is not permitted. Yes, no?
Yeah.
Alright, can I move on to the next? Financial assets, can you reclassify? Meaning, can you move from ACM category to FVOCI? Six combination we saw. Can we do, sir?
Yeah.
Yes. Thumb rule is what? You use fair value. And check to which category you are jumping to. And accordingly, gain loss will go into that category. If you are jumping into OCI category, that means gain loss will go to OCI.
Yeah.
But there were some exceptions to the thumb rule. One exception is, from FVTPL, if you're going to FVOCI, gain or loss will still go to P&L only. Correct? And if you're moving out of FVOCI category, then OCI balance is not required. Correct? No. If you're going from FVOCI, in fact, here only it is there. Why should I write? You're going from FVOCI to ACM method. Correct? No. Then OCI balance is transferred to financial asset. That is bond, you remember? You transfer to financial asset itself. But if you're going from FVT OCI to FVTPL, then OCI will be transferred to SPL. And these are thumb rule ka exceptions. None, no. Impairment, no. We know impairment is done only on those assets measured at ACM or only on ACM and FVT OCI asset. Because FVTPL assets anyway, gain loss will anyway go to P&L. No point in doing impairment for that. Correct? Impairment is also known as credit loss or loss allowance. And the method we choose is what? Credit loss allowance, expected credit loss method is what we use. For this, we require probability of default. Probability of default can be two things. One, either 12-month probability or lifetime probability. Correct? No? If money is outstanding on financial asset for more than 30 days, that means what? There has significant risk. So for such, we have to use what? Lifetime POD. Otherwise, we use 12-month POD. Correct? No? Impairment loss is a simple calculation. Just multiplication of three things. Okay, that we have brought in the formula there. What is regular way purchase and sale of financial asset? Regular way means it's a contract to purchase or sale of financial asset which requires a delivery. The delivery should be within the stipulated time, and the time should be regulated by a particular authority. Correct or no? These are the five features. If it is a regular way purchase, either you can account do trade date accounting or you can do settlement date accounting. If you're doing trade date accounting, then what? On the trade date itself, financial asset will be recognized or financial liability will be recognized. Both buyer and seller, on that day itself, they will record. Fine, huh? Yeah. And then you check. Subsequent accounting is as per the respective methods. That financial asset, if it goes to ACM method, subsequent fair value is ignored. Correct? If you are measuring that financial asset under FV OCI method, then the difference between transaction date and settlement date ka fair value will be recognized in OCI. If it is FVTPL, trade date, difference between trade date and settlement date ka fair value will be transferred off to P&L. Correct? No? That is the thing. No. Settlement date. On the settlement date, contract date, will we pass any journal entry? No journal entry. Correct? Between trade date and settlement date, if there is any balance sheet date, what we have to do? We have to record the gain loss. Correct? No? Only that gain loss portion we have to record. Fine, on the balance sheet date, for ACM, not required. Correct? But for FVOCI and FVTPL asset, gain loss will be going into P&L. Correct? This is on the balance sheet date. Fine? For settlement date, what will happen? Under ACM method, you will record now, because you have not yet recorded the asset. Now you record the asset or liability. Fine? And FVTPL, FVOCI, same. No. It'll be any fair value changes you recognize in OCI or FVTPL. Will seller recognize gain loss, sir?
No.
Fair value gain loss is not done by the seller. Fair enough? He'll only compare what? The carrying amount of the asset with selling price. That is the gain loss for him. Fair value gain loss, he will not record. Because he has anyway sold the asset. No, he's not interested in fair value anymore. Fine, no? Alright, next one. Derecognition of financial asset. When will you derecognize financial asset? One, when cash flow has expired, debtors paid the cash. Or when the right to receive the cash flows and risk and reward has been transferred. Remember, interest strip sold. Like that example. When can you say risk and reward has been transferred? I give you three examples. One, it should be unconditional sale. If you have any repurchase option, then repurchase price should be at fair value. Correct? And three, if you have any call or put option, that call and put option should be deeply out of money. In these three circumstances, you can say risk and reward is transferred. Ulta of this, if you do, risk and reward is not transferred. Correct? No. Examples are given. Manageable. And third condition is that when no control is retained. You can say that no control is retained when the buyer can sell this asset entirely to unrelated third party. On these three criteria, we derecognize financial assets. Okay.
Yeah.
Is partial derecognition allowed? Yes. We took hold the example. Interest strip sold fully. That means derecognize interest strip.
Yeah.
But interest strip sold partially. Let's say 90%. That means you'll only derecognize 90%. You have sold principal and interest strip. Both you have sold partially. 90% of principal and 90% of interest you have sold. That means what? Derecognize 90% of principal and interest strip. Yes or no?
No.
But if you give only first right of cash flows to somebody, or if you have transferred the cash flows only up to a certain tenure, then it is not derecognition of financial assets. Yes, we have seen this through one of the case studies. Does that make sense?
No.
All right. What sensor? You're going full rocket speed. It's okay. We should go that only. No problem. We go through it once again. I'm just giving you a quick recap of it. That's it. Whatever we have done. Okay. Securitization. In debt securitization, what will happen, sir? You transfer it to SPV. SPV will make it into smaller units and sell it to investors. Correct? When you have sold the units to investors, can we derecognize financial asset? Yes, provided three conditions are satisfied. One, we don't have any obligation to pay unless we recover the money on the original loan.
Yeah.
On the loan, if you recover the EMI, then only we will pay it to the investors. Otherwise, no obligation, correct or no? And once you have received the money from investor, once you have received the money from the loan borrower, you have to pay that money to the investor without any material delay.
No.
There should not be any delay, correct? No. And you should not be able to pledge this asset or sell this asset again, because you already pledged it. Again, you can't pledge it. Fine. Now, under these three circumstances, you can derecognize. You can derecognize financial asset, correct? No. Otherwise, you can't. If you have transferred the asset, but they don't qualify for derecognition, meaning if you can't cancel it, then what you'll do? Will you cancel financial asset?
No,
financial asset will not be cancelled, meaning don't derecognize financial asset. You would have already received some money. What will you do for that? Huh? Treat the amount received as financial liability. It is not trade, it is treat. Treat the amount received as financial liability. And apply ACM for that financial liability. Got it? That's it. Alright, next. Continuing involvement in asset. When will this come? Na garka na gatka scenario. Edbidangi. Neither have you transferred fully nor have you retained fully. In that case, what? We pass one journal entry. What is the journal entry? Bank account debit. Continuing involvement in asset account debit. Continuing involvement will be recorded at lower of two things. Carrying amount or guarantee amount, whichever is lower. Correct? P&L will be balancing figure. Correct? No. Alright. To financial asset carrying amount to associated liability. Associated liability will be recognized at guarantee amount plus fair value of guarantee amount. Correct? No. Here one more entry should come, that is P&L account debit. Loss on whatever is about, this is will be as balancing figure. Yeah, yes, no?
Yeah.
Alright, next. Derecognition of financial liability. When will you derecognize financial liability? When either you have paid the cash or you have given any other financial asset. Creditor gave equity shares. Can you derecognize? Yes. Correct or no? Or we have waived off. Creditor told, I don't want cash.
Yeah.
Then you can waive off. Meaning you can derecognize. Done, no? Debt restructuring. Debt restructuring means what, sir? Modification, extinguishment, remember?
Yeah.
First, we need to check two things. What are the two things we compare? Present value using old effective interest rate. Cash flows under new scheme. Any fees paid, any fees received. Any fees if you have received means you have to deduct that.
Yeah.
This portion you compare it with other portion. What is other portion? Present value of remaining cash flows under original, or we simply call it as what? Carrying amount on modification date. You just compare it with that. If the difference is greater than or equal to 10, then substantial modification is done. So we have to do extinguishment accounting. Yes or no? That's what we have written here. Substantially different terms. If it is answer to this is yes, the difference is greater than or equal to 10%. Extinguishment accounting. Otherwise, modification accounting. Extinguishment accounting means derecognize old financial liability, recognize new financial liability. Yes or no? The difference between these two will go off to P&L. Any fees and all, if you have paid, will directly be transferred off to P&L. Under modification accounting, will we derecognize financial liability or it will continue? But we have to adjust the carrying amount.
Yes.
Meaning any cost if you have paid like legal fees, it is deducted from the carrying amount of financial liability. Hence, it will get revised. Yes or no?
Yeah.
Since cash flow and all has changed, EIR would have changed. Hence, you have to find out new effective interest rate.
New
present value you have to do, and then do the amortization for that new year. Using new EIR, again prepare amortization table and do the accounting. Yes. Debt for equity swaps. Today only we saw.
Yeah.
Instead of paying cash, our debtor is paying equity shares.
Yeah.
Equity shares should be recorded at fair value.
Yeah.
If you can't measure equity shares at fair value, then you use fair value of liability transfer. Fair value of liability transfer only will be taken as fair value of equity shares. Easy. If there is any difference, that difference will be going off to SPL. Derivative. Derivative means three features.
Yeah.
Value changes due to underlying, investment is little or no, future settlement. Future settlement could be gross or it could be net. Yes or no?
Yeah.
For derivative, on the trade date, will we pass any journal entry? That depends, sir. For options or if any premium is paid, then you will pay, then you will treat it as financial asset derivative to bank if you have paid it.
Yeah.
For others, no journal entry, correct? No, because there is no fair value.
Yeah.
On settlement date, you do FVTPL accounting. Meaning gain loss will go off to SPL, correct? No?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, there's one more here. If underlying asset varies, underlying varies on non-financial, okay, underline varies on due to non-financial variables specific to one party. It is not a derivative. I'll give you a simple example for this. There's one more component, okay? This I didn't cover. I'll just quickly cover it here. You have a residual value, sir. Residual value of PP. Okay? A and B are betting on the residual value. This is not a derivative contract, is what the standard is saying. Why is it not a derivative contract? One, first, the standard uses the term, if your contract has a non-financial variable, if your contract has a non-financial variable and that non-financial variable is related to a specific party or specific to one party, then it is not a derivative. Two things I said here. What did I say? If it has a non-financial variable and if it is specific to one party, then such contracts are not derivative contracts. Let's look at this example. You have a residual value.
Yeah.
Two people are betting on the residual value. All right. So residual value is dependent on usage condition, no?
Yeah.
Correct. How you use the PP based on that residual value will be determined. If you use it well, you'll get more residual value. If you use it badly, you'll get less residual value. Correct, no? I mean, this residual value is dependent on usage. Correct? Is usage a monetary component or it's a non-financial variable? Using something is financial variables or non-financial variable? Non-financial variable. Condition one satisfied? And who's going to use it? Both of them or only one? PP can be used by both the parties or only one party, sir? Only one. That means it is related to one party only, no? That such contracts are not derivative contracts. Just know this. It's not been asked much, but just we have just got it. Is it okay? If any contract has a non-financial variable and it relates to only one party, then it is not a derivative contract. Residual value example, you can keep it. Okay. And moreover, derivative can be gross settlement also. No. Here, let's say A is using this asset. After this, will he transfer the asset to B or only he'll give gain loss? Only gain loss, yes or no? That means what? You can't transact, you can't do this on a matlab, gross settlement, not possible in such contracts. That's another reason probably why they would have said that this is not a derivative contract. Are we fine? Or just don't write all that in exam. If in exam, if it comes, just write this only. If any contract has a non-financial variable and that variable is related to only one party, then such contracts are not derivative. That's what I've written here. Is it okay?
No.
Underline. If underline varies due to non-financial variable specific to one party, then it is not a derivative. Okay. Embedded derivative, ED. Embedded derivative means what? We have to check first. You have to first check it is embedded with what? Is it embedded with financial asset or financial liability now? If it is embedded with financial asset, should we need to separate it or we'll follow FVTPL? Generally, that financial asset will fail CCF criteria. Hence, it will be already accounted under FVTPL. So continue to account it under FVTPL only, correct? If it is financial liability or non-financial asset with derivative, then you have to check whether it is closely related or not. If it is closely related, then recognize full contract using FVTPL. Yes. If it is not closely related, but then we need to check, can we separate it? If the answer to this is no, we can't separate, means we'll record them as one contract using FVTPL. Yes. If you can separate it, but already it's accounted under FVTPL. Host is already accounted in FVTPL, means does it make sense to separate?
No.
No, that means if FVTPL is opted, that means you don't have to separate, account the whole contract under FVTPL. Suppose host is not accounted under FVTPL, then you have to separate. Correct? No. Separated host and derivative. Host will be accounted under respective Ind AS. Derivative will always be accounted under FVTPL. I can't say always, just now we learned which account. Hedge. In hedge, that rule will get break. Otherwise, derivative will always be accounted under FVTPL. Making sense, I believe. You remember fair value hedge?
Yeah.
And derivative, where did it go? Did we use it under did we transfer gain loss to P&L or it went to OCI? For fair value hedge of equity. There only under certain exception, derivative, we don't use FVTPL. Otherwise, FVTPL method only for derivative. Okay, no? Any confusion? I am giving you certain examples. This only we wrote in today's class also, no? Company in India, dollar, blah, blah, blah. Same thing you wrote in today's class notes only, correct? This is simple, correct? If you have any prepayment option in loan, then what, sir? Generally, prepayment option we treat it as they are not closely related. But if two conditions are satisfied, then we can treat it as it is closely related. One is what? Prepayment price approximates ACM balance each year. Then we treat it as no need to separate, account it as one. Fine, no? Correct. Second condition was what? One more year. We're not called out here. One more condition is what? Compensation of lost interest. Whatever interest lost, we find out the present value of that, and if you're giving it to the investor back, in that case also, we don't have to separate. Yes or no? But they don't have exam relevance much, hence we have not brought in. Okay, now? Alright, next. Foreign currency embedded derivative. We have a separation rules for foreign currency. What is this thumb rule or separation rule? First, we have to find out the contract term and use the forward contract for that contracted term. Host is accounted using forward rate for contracted term. Yes or no? On the contract date, will we pass any journal entry for derivative? No fair value, so hence no journal entry. Because generally we enter into forward contracts for here. No options will be there. Fine, no? On reporting date, what will happen? Compare forward rate for contract term with forward rate for the remaining period. Balance sheet date, no? You keep comparing. If there is any gain loss, what will happen? Gain means you will record financial asset. Loss means you will record financial liability. We have done in today's session only. Yes or no? Should be able to relate this, correct? No? Okay, next. Settlement date. Settlement date also same thing. Compare the gain loss. Make, if there is any change in fair value loss, there is a gain asset. If there is a loss, financial liability, correct? But is it actual derivative accounting or it's a notional accounting? That means what will happen to the financial asset derivative or financial liability derivative balance? It will be transferred to the host balance. The host could be either financial asset like debtors or it will be financial liability known as payables, correct? No, because it is a notion. Fine. Since you bought in unnecessary dollars or unnecessary extra currency into place, we are forced to do this accounting. Yes, no? Any confusion, sir? No. Disclosure, have you already discussed? So I think you can just remember 5 to 6 of them. Hedge accounting, just no, we saw. Correct or no? Hedging means to cover the risk. Risk could be due to recognized asset, liability, firm commitment, or highly probable forecast transaction. Yes, no, sir? In hedging accounting, there will be two instruments already. Hedged item and hedging instrument. Hedged item is the one exposed to risk. Yes or no? Hedging instrument you use to cover that risk. Huh? For you to follow hedge accounting, there were three conditions. ECR. There must be economic relationship between HI and HHI. Credit risk should not be dominant like factoring. Third one, hedge ratio should be based on actual quantity of risk. Okay. Then hedge accounting you can follow means now you have to figure out which hedge. Cash flow hedge, fair value hedge, hedge of net investment in foreign operation. Cash flow hedge means what it is? Cash flow variance risk is there. Hence we are doing cash flow hedge. Correct? What do we do here? From transaction date till settlement date, gain loss on hedged item and hedging instrument. We'll go to cash flow hedge reserve because all these are bookish loss.
Yes.
Correct? Only the actual loss on contract will be transferred from cash flow hedge reserve to P&L over the contract duration. Due to passage of time, you go on transferring. Yes or no? At the end, the cash flow reserve account should get balanced. So, meaning debit side total should be equal to credit side total. Easy? For fair value hedge means what? There is a fair value change risk. Correct? What did fair value hedge reserve say? Don't open any OCI and all. Transfer everything to P&L. Correct or no? Whether you're doing under ACM, FVTPL or FVOCI debt, everything will go off to P&L. But there is one exception. If you have any equity instruments, if you are measuring under OCI, then it's irrevocable. Now you change the derivative accounting. Now gain loss on both of this will not go to P&L, it will go off to OCI. That is one exception, correct? No?
Yeah.
Last one is hedge of net investment in foreign operations. You have some foreign subsidiary. So investment ka value change, there is a risk. And if they pay any dividend, there is again cash flow risk. Here what did they say? Same as cash flow hedge only, but here the balance will not be transferred to CHFR, cash flow hedge reserve. It will be transferred to FCTR, foreign currency translation reserve. Correct? No. If you sell the effective portion will go to FCTR, if ineffective portion will go to P&L. When it will become ineffective? When you sell that foreign subsidiary ka investment, either fully or partially. If you have sold 20%, that means that 20% balance will go from FCTR to P&L. Like that. Got it? That's all. This is the revision on financial instruments. Okay, we'll share this anyway. You can go through. Alright, I was just giving you an overview as to how to read the chart. That's it. Fine enough? Thank you so much.